I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish.
No man can fully grasp how far and how fast we have come. But condense, if you will, the 50,000 years of man's recorded history in a time span of but a half a century. Stated in these terms, we know very little about the first 40 years, except at the end of them, advanced man had learned to use the skins of animals to cover them. Then about 10 years ago, under this standard, man emerged from his caves to construct other kinds of shelter. Only 5 years ago, man learned to write and use a cart with wheels. Christianity began less than 2 years ago. The printing press came this year. And then less than 2 months ago, during this whole 50-year span of human history, steam engine provided a new source of power. Newton explored the meaning of gravity. Last month, electric lights and telephones and automobiles and airplanes became available. Only last week did we develop penicillin and television and nuclear power. And now, if America's new spacecraft succeeds in reaching Venus, we will have literally reached the stars before midnight tonight. This is a breathtaking pace, and such a pace cannot help but create new ills as it dispels old. New ignorance, new problems, new dangers. Surely the opening vistas of space promise high costs and hardships as well as high reward. So it is not surprising that some would have us stay where we are a little longer, to rest, to wait. But this city of Houston, this state of Texas, this country of the United States was not built by those who waited and rested and wished to look behind them. For the eyes of the world now look into space, to the moon, and to the planets beyond. And we have vowed that we shall not see it governed by a hostile flag of conquest, but by a banner of freedom and peace. The exploration of space will go ahead, whether we join in it or not. And it is one of the great adventures of all time. Those who came before us made certain that this country rode the first waves of the Industrial Revolution, the first waves of modern invention. and the first wave of nuclear power. And this generation does not intend to founder in the backwash of the coming age of space. We mean to be a part of it. We mean to lead it. Its hazards are hostile to us all. Its conquest deserves the best of all mankind. And its opportunity for peaceful cooperation may never come again. But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why, 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win on the other side.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
I think the momentous, most memorable thing that I can recall about that particular day was the opportunity while my two friends here were being put into the spacecraft to stand alone by myself out there and look at the rocket and the quietness and see the sun come up and the waves rolling in and the evidence of the millions of people watching, but nothing specific and just so quiet. Realize that indeed such a contrast was going to take place, all the frantic activity preparing the rocket, but it was so quiet up there for me personally, and that in a very few moments we were going to be departing in a great roar and off for a momentous event.
We had a 90% chance of getting back safely to Earth on that flight, but only a 50-50 chance of making a successful landing on the first attempt. There's so many unknowns in that descending from lunar orbit down to the surface that had not been demonstrated yet by testing. It's a risk-reward equation, and you're able to accept a level of risk so long as it's commensurate with the reward that you will get by achieving the goal that you're after.
T-minus 1 minute 35 seconds on the Apollo mission, the flight to land of the first men on the moon. All indications coming in to the control center at this time indicate we are go. 1 minute 25 seconds and counting. Our status board indicates the third stage completely pressurized. 80-second mark has now been passed. We'll go on full internal power at the 50-second mark in the countdown. Guidance system goes on internal at 17 seconds, leading up to the ignition sequence at 8.9 seconds. We're approaching the 60-second mark on the Apollo 11 mission. T-minus 60 seconds and counting. We pass T-minus 60. 55 seconds and counting. Neil Armstrong just reported back. It's been a real smooth countdown. We passed the 50-second mark. Power transfer is complete. We're on internal power with the launch vehicle at this time. 40 seconds away from the Apollo 11 liftoff. All the second stage tanks now pressurized. 35 seconds and counting. We are still go with Apollo 11. 30 seconds and counting. Astronauts report it feels good. T-minus 25 seconds. 20 seconds and counting. T-minus 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11. Tower clear.
We got a roll program. Neil Armstrong reporting their roll and pitch program, which puts Apollo 11 on proper heading.
I think certainly to go as far away as the moon and look back on the Earth certainly does affect your perspective. And then when you see it, tiny as your thumbnail held out in front of you at arm's length. That sort of gets your attention. A beautiful sight. Tiny, pristine, blue and white, very fragile looking object, shining like a beautiful little headlight out there in the black velvet of space. It does change your perspective. It makes you think that we have to take better care of this little fragile entity, because it is fragile.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. Slightly less than 1 minute to ignition, and everything is go.
Roger, Apollo 11's go.
Apollo 11, this is Houston, your go for separation. Our system's recommendation is arm both pyro buses, over.
Okay, pyro B coming armed. My intent is to use bottle primary one as per the checklist, therefore I just turned A on.
Roger, we concur with the logic. This is Houston, radio check, over.
Roger, we've got the high gain locked on now, I believe, auto track and narrow.
Okay, you're coming in loud and clear, but Mike is just barely readable.
Hello, it's Neil. How are you reading, Mike?
Loud and clear now, Mike, and we understand that you are docked.
That's right. Houston, we're ready for LEM ejection.
Roger, you're go for LEM ejection.
Thank you.
Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Roger, Houston, Apollo 11, go ahead.
Roger, could you give us some comments on how the transposition and docking went, over?
Yeah, I thought it went pretty well, Houston, although I expect I used more gas than I've been using in the simulator. Except for using a little more gas, and I'd be interested in your numbers on that. Everything went nominally.
This is Houston. Roger, we copy.
Eagle Houston, the alignment and the initialization look good to us, over.
Roger, thank you.
Eagle Houston, would you have Columbia go to the high gain yaw zero pitch minus 20, over. Apollo 11, Houston, we are go for undocking, over.
Roger, understand. Roger, Eagle for undock.
Roger, how does it look?
The Eagle has wind.
Roger. Eagle Houston, we see you on the steerable, over.
I do believe you got thrusters on board that vehicle. Okay, you've got it. Do it, David.
Roger, let us know when you're ready to copy. We have a DOI pad and a PDI pad, over.
Guidance says we're going. Coming up on 5 minutes to ignition, Gene Kranz getting a go, no-go for descent.
Okay, all flight controllers, I'm going around the horn. Just going to make your go, no-go, based on the data you have for an LOS. See, we got it back. Give me another few seconds. We're going back. Okay, retro, go. Vital, go. Guide, go. Control, go. Delcom, go. GNC, go. Decom, go. Surgeon, go. Capcom, we're go to continue PDI.
Mike.
How you doing, Neil?
I'll leave it blue. Relay to us. See if they got me now. I got good signal strength in blue.
Okay, you should have me now, Houston.
Eagle, we got you now. It's looking good. Over. Eagle, Houston, after yaw around, angled S-band pitch, minus 9er, yaw, plus 1-8.
Altitude 5,200 feet.
Manual attitude control is good.
Roger, copy.
Altitude 4,200.
Houston, you're a go for landing, over.
Roger, understand. Go for landing. 3,000 feet. Attack alarm. 1201. 1201.
Roger, 1201 alarm. We're go. Same type. We're go.
2,000 feet. 2,000 feet. Into the ag. 47 degrees.
Roger.
47 degrees.
Eagle looking great. You're go.
Altitude 1600. 1400 feet, still looking very good.
Roger, 1202, we copy it.
35 degrees. 35 degrees, 750, coming down to 23. 700 feet, 21 down, 33 degrees. 100 feet, down to 19. 540 feet down to 30 and a 15. And 400 feet down at 9. Gate forward. 1050 feet down at 4. 30, drift and a half down. They're pegged on horizontal velocity. Standard speed down 3.5. 47 forward. On 1.5 down. 70. 70. Got your shadow up there. 50 down at 2.5. 19 forward. Altitude, velocity, light. 3.5 down. 220 feet. 15 forward. 11 forward, coming down nicely. 200 feet. 4.5 down. 5.5 down. Within 60 feet. 6.5 down. 5.5 down. 9 forward. 120 feet. 100 feet, 3.5 down, 9 forward, 5%. On any bite? 75 feet, that is looking good, down a half. 6 forward.
60 seconds.
Lights on. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. 40 feet down, 2.5. Picking up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Make shadow. 4 forward. 4 forward, drifting to the right level. Down and a half.
30 seconds.
Forward. Contact light. Okay, engine stop. APA at a descent. Boat control, both auto descent, engine command override off. Engine arm off. 413 is in.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
I'm at the foot of the ladder. The LAM footbeds are only depressed in the surface about 1 or 2 inches, although the surface appears to be very, very fine-grained as you get close to it. It's almost like a powder. Ground mass is very fine. I'm going to step off the LAM now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. As the surface is fine and powdery, I can pick it up loosely with my toe. It does adhere in fine layers, like powdered charcoal, to the sole and sides of my boot. I only go in a small fraction of an inch, maybe an eighth of an inch, but I can see the footprints of my boots and the treads and the fine sandy particles.
Neil, this is Houston. We're copying.
There seems to be no difficulty in moving around as we suspected. It's even perhaps easier than the simulations of 1/6G that we performed in various simulations on the ground. Absolutely no trouble to walk around.
Neil and Buzz, the President of the United States is in his office now and would like to say a few words to you. Over.
That would be an honor.
Go ahead, Mr. President. This is Houston out.
Hello, Neil and Buzz. I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House, and this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made. I just can't tell you how proud we all are of what you do. For every American, this has to be the proudest day of our lives. And for people all over the world, I am sure they too join with Americans in recognizing what an immense feat this is. Because of what you have done, the heavens have become a part of man's world. And as you talk to us from the Sea of Tranquility, it inspires us to redouble our efforts to bring peace and tranquility to Earth. For one priceless moment in the whole history of man, all the people on this Earth are truly one. One in their pride in what you have done, and one in our prayers that you will return safely to Earth.
Thank you, Mr. President. It's a great honor and privilege for us to be here representing not only the United States, but men of peace of all nations, and with interest and a curiosity, and with a vision for the future. Honor for us to be able to participate here today.
And thank you very much, and I look forward, all of us look forward, to seeing you on the Hornet on Thursday.
Tranquility Base, Houston.
Roger, go ahead.
Roger, our guidance recommendation is pings, and you're cleared for takeoff.
Roger, understand. We're number one on the runway.
Roger.
Houston, we got the service module going by.
Roger, thank you.
And it's rotating just like it should be. Thrusters are firing.
About 3 or 4 minutes through Redstone and pick you up after blackout through Orion.
Roger.
Guidance reports Apollo 11 right down the middle of the corridor. 11 Houston, you're going over the hill there shortly. You're looking mighty fine to us.
See you later.
This nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out
of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish.
Thank you.